digitization, one of the most important concepts in digital libraries. See, the essential components are digital objects are the basic contents of a digital repository. If one wishes to have older documents are digital objects, otherwise called, digitization is a prerequisite. Obviously, born digital documents do not require digitization. They may sometimes require only change of format. Here I would like to emphasize the difference between digitized objects and born digital objects. Born digital objects are already you have in digitized format, whereas the things which are in print format or in some other format, they require to be digitized, so we call them as digitized objects. So digitization differs from one object to another, as they can be any of the following objects, because in case of text, the digitization is different from the digitization of images and digitization of audio files or digitization of video files. So born digital are digitized objects. Normally born digital objects are generated by Office suites like MS Office or LibreOffice or OpenOffice, or probably in case of images, they might have been captured by digital cameras or digital camcorders. We know that nowadays even video recording equipment come with the digital side of it. Then MIDI devices in case of musical instruments. Then non-digital objects are printed, typed or typed. In case of old theses or old papers or journal publications, mostly they might have been in a printed form, in which case you may have to digitize them. So is the case if you have photographs which were taken with ordinary cameras, which are non-digital cameras, then you may have to digitize the images. Similarly, the movie of some films, old films, you have to digitize, then you require digitization. So digitization is nothing but the process of converting non-digital objects into digital form, so that they can be archived on a repository. Digitization of text and images we will talk first. There are two main capturing devices. Those are scanners and digital cameras. Flatbed scanners, face-up scanners, feed-through scanners, hand scanners. So that means scanners come in different sizes, different avatars. Okay. Then you have, of course, digital cameras also. Then, so what scanners should be used for what kind of material? Okay, for example, if you have single leaf, for example, a letter you want to digitize, or some regular size single leaf, that is A4 size, and just a flat material, then probably either a flatbed scanner or sheet fed scanner or digital camera. Okay, so actually if you see across the columns, digital cameras are common for all kinds of material, and we have scanners which are just plain A4 size scanners. Sometimes these scanners come with an attachment where you can put 50 loose sheets and you keep on moving the sheets, just as in the case of Xerox machines. Then if the material is single leaf but large size and flat material, then obviously if you have some leaf which is more than A4 size, then probably you require oversized flatbed scanners. In fact, I have seen even scanners of A0 size. Then of course sheet feed and digital cameras. If you have bound material, which is a little tricky affair to digitize, digital cameras with book cradle. Book cradle, what it does is, it has two platforms so that you can raise one platform and lower another platform. Say, for example, if your book is having some 500 pages, so it's a thick one. When you take probably 400 pages on one side, one or two pages on the another cradle, so that on the whole, the both the pages would be flat material rather than curved. One of the tricky issues with regard to bound volumes is the image gets skewed, that means rounded off. Then of course we have software to straighten the image and read it as a straight line. But on the whole, digital cameras with the book cradle is important to get a kind of a flat image. Then you can also use overhead flatbed scanners where the camera is fixed on the top and taken a photograph. Then transparent material, and good old days we have many transparencies before PowerPoint presentations came into picture. The transparency, mostly the lectures are prepared on transparent material. This is the case with the films also. For example, if you want to take a photograph of a film to be digitized, then you require a special attachment for slide scanners, film scanners, multi-format flatbed scanners, and digital cameras can be used. That means on the whole, when you want to digitize, it depends on the size and the transparency or non-transparent material, just printed material. So these factors are to be considered from this table when you choose a scanner to digitize. Then let us talk about when we take images, at what resolution and what color depth you require. Image quality definitely depends on the resolution, okay? And image quality also depends on the color depth. In a small, the present day computers can generate even 1 billion color shades, okay? So is the case nowadays. You might have seen TV advertisements saying that HD quality, 4K, 8K, that means the resolution is quite high, almost looks like a natural color depth with high resolution. So image quality definitely depends on resolution, that is the number of dots per inch, also called pixels, picture elements, that is PPI also, the picture elements per inch. Higher resolution means more dots per inch, bigger the file size. But one should be careful, if we keep on increasing the resolution, size may be bigger, but with no extra benefit. That means there is an optimum level of resolution. Highest resolution does not mean you get the best quality. Once it reaches the optimum level of resolution, probably you may have to stop increasing the resolution, because instead of offering any better, it only the size file size becomes bigger. So image quality depends on the resolution. We know that the number of dots per inch are pixels per inch. Higher the resolution, more DPI. Now if you look at the matrix of it, picture quality also depends on color depth. In an 8-bit color depth, you can generate about 256 color shades. But if we allot 16-bit color shades, that means we get about 32,000 colors. If it is 24, 16.8. 30-bit color depth means almost 1 billion colors. So much of the time, you can see that the present-day computers can handle even 32-bit color shades. But of course, obviously, if you use 32-bit color, the file size increases. Now, the best practices of digitization, because one of the biggest challenges of digitization is long-term preservation. Okay, we know that the tricky problem with preservation is the format and file sizes, all these factors depend on how long you can preserve your data, whether it is in image or text. So many people suggest in case of text, a minimum of 600 dpi and uncompressed TIFF format. Okay. And finally, when you want to host it on a web, in a repository or something like that, perhaps one can convert the TIFF format into JPEG or PDF files so that they can be hosted on the web. See, here the important point, TIFF in uncompressed format results in a higher file size and perhaps unfit for transmitting over network because it takes a lot of network bandwidth. Whereas JPEG, once it is converted into JPEG or PDF, the file size becomes fairly manageable to transfer over a network. But again, why do we suggest 600 and uncompressed is, this is for preservation purpose, so that in future, this can be pulled out and transformed into another format other than JPEG or PDF. And this is especially important when we are applying optical character recognition on text images of some text material. For example, right now, if a particular language or script doesn't have OCR software, probably right now we just store it in TIFF and 600 dpi. Once the OCR software for a particular language, say for example, some Telugu or Tamil, is available, we can pull out from the archives the uncompressed 600 dpi TIFF format, apply OCR software and convert that into a text file. So software for images and OCR, okay, normally many scanners come with the software for image editing, but sometimes some of them are open source software, some of them are the digital library software, the optical character recognition software. Adobe Photoshop is a commercial software, but you can use in Linux-based systems either GIMP or any other software that comes with the operating system. So other kind of software is optical character recognition. Okay, we have OmniPage and Ebbe Fine Reader. Sometimes these software are bundled with the scanner, where even if a commercial software is there, you may get free along with the scanner. So image formats, you have image formats, there are plethora of image formats. The most popular perhaps are GIF, JPEG, PNG. As in the case of many things in the world, each format has its advantages and disadvantages. So GIF is graphics interchange format, JPEG is giant photographic exports group format, PNG is portable network graphics specification. Okay. Now, JPEG, let us look into the advantages and disadvantages of JPEG. It is good for use with photographs, screenshots of games, movie stills, that is when you are playing a movie, you can capture some of the scenes as an image. Then desktop backgrounds, advantage is file size is smaller. Okay, but JPEG is not particularly suitable for Windows application screenshots. For example, if you are taking any Windows application, a screenshot of that, probably JPEG is not the right format. Then line art also, JPEG is not a good one to capture line art like cartoons and other things. Where in fact any image where fine lines and sharp colors are required, probably JPEG is not quite suitable to store in that format. PNG, it is very good for text and line art. Just now we have seen for line art, JPEG is not good, but in that case, PNG is a better choice. Or comic style drawings, general web graphics. And it is also suitable, unlike the JPEG, Windows application screenshots, okay? And especially 100% quality is required, that is 24-bit color depth is also required. PNG is a better choice. Then when alpha channel support is also required, you require PNG. As a general replacement for anything that is non-animated like GIF. GIF only advantage being animations can be created in GIF format. Then PNG is not suitable for photos in game screenshots. So that means it shares this quality of not being a good choice with JPEG. Important when you are looking for small files, okay. So PNG obviously generates a larger file, okay. Unfortunately, some browsers don't support PNG format to display the images. Then GIF, of course, it's a very old one. It is very useful and ideal for where animations are absolutely required. That means if you take two, three images, one after the another, we can create animation effect. Of course, widespread browser support because it is one of the oldest formats. But bad for patented legal technicalities for the simple reason this is a proprietary standard and not an open standard as in the case of JPEG. It also generates large file sizes compared to PNG. That means of the three images we have covered so far, I think GIF takes the largest file size. More or less it is obsolete, but again, it doesn't mean it is not being used on many sites. Then we come to the OCR software. So right now we covered only the images and the formats. Then what exactly is OCR software? This software scans any printed text and converts the scanned image into a text, either ASCII or Unicode, or any format like DOC or PDF or RTF, RTF rich text format or XSL. Okay. This is essential because scanned images of text cannot be indexed. That is the problem with the images, because if you scan a page of a text from a textbook or something like that, it only remains as an image, but it is not an ASCII file or Unicode file, so it cannot be indexed. For it to be indexed, we have to apply optical character recognition software so that the component images in each page are converted to actual text, that is a word. It will be in a text rather than a word. So plain text files occupy, besides, much lesser file space compared to images of the text. So you have to distinguish between text and images of the text. When you scan, you only produce an image of a text, but not actual text. To convert that into a text, you require OCR software, okay? So there are many good software, as mentioned earlier, like Ebbe Fine Reader or other software. OmniPage is one good one. Then capturing audio. Now we have to, thus far we have dealt with capturing images and the text, okay, and using OCR software in case of text. Now we will try to cover how to capture audio. So normally this is achieved by attaching an audio player to a system through an audio capture card. And finally we store it in one of the audio formats like WAV or MP3 or MIDI. So again, in this case also, there are digital audio capture equipment, in which case you don't have to convert that into digital format, but analog audio, for example, old tapes, cassette tapes, where you have some songs or speeches by the old celebrities. You have to convert them into digital format. So let us look into the formats of audio. The most commonly used format is WAV format, because it is used on Microsoft Windows operating system. It can be used on internet, good for multimedia authoring. You know, there are again multimedia authoring software are there, where of course the if the audio is in WAV format, authoring is easier. Flexible and handles both compressed and uncompressed storage format. See, mostly whether it is image or audio or video, when we talk about formats, basically we are talking about the compression algorithms they are using. So most powerful compression algorithms may end up in a smaller file, and you have to uncompress while you are playing the document. Then MIDI files, that is musical instrument digital interface, used mostly in multimedia industry for audio control. So if you can directly connect a guitar to a computer and store it in MIDI format. MP3, of course, this is the most popular for its compression advantages. MPEG layer 3, most popular of the audio files, ensures almost CD quality of music. You know, music connoisseurs always look for what kind of quality each format ensures. It is true, sometimes high compression, when you decompress, probably you lose quality. Any compression, decompression may be a little lossy, but how much lossy can be tolerated is the biggest question. So if something ensures least loss, then and most compression, that means the file size would be very, very small, naturally that is opted, where MP3 scores a lot over WAV files. In my experience, something like 18 MB WAV file becomes a 3 MB MP3 file. That is, I think, the biggest attraction without much loss. Okay. So a minute of music takes only 1 MB file. If you consider many of the songs are only 3 to 5 minutes, probably 3 to 5 MB. Players are available on many of the operating systems like Linux, Mac, or Microsoft Windows. Now, let us go through the video files. A video capture card is required to record a video file, and input from video cassette players or movie cameras. Nowadays, camcorders are coming where directly the video which you have filmed will be converted into one of the video format. But again, if you have older equipment, I mean the old video cameras, probably they might have stored in analog format, in which case you have to convert that into a digital format. Then these video cards can take input from TV antennas or cables or VCR or movie cameras. Okay. So that means, for example, if you want to capture the videos from your TV or some other old VCR systems, you require them to be digitized into one of the video formats. The digital file can be saved either in MOV, MOV format, or AVI, or DIVX, or MPEG. Of course, I mentioned only 3-4 of them. It doesn't mean there are only 4 video formats. There are many, as in the case of images, but we only are covering the most important ones. Let us look into one of the formats, which is called AVI, Audio Video Interleaved. It was developed by Microsoft. And AVI player drivers are required to play this format. So normally you require a driver for that. You know, in case of any images or anything, you require software drivers. So the frame rates are not as high as other video formats such as MPEG. not much development is going on this file format. That means AVI is slowly becoming outdated, though still many software you can run AVI files and watch the movies. Then we have another format called MOV. Movie files are the most common format used by QuickTime movies under the Mac operating system. Okay. So we have another format called MPEG. This is the most popular one. I prefer this for the simple reason it's an open standard like JPEG in case of images. So most popular format on the internet, high quality video at a fairly low data rates. Okay. In conclusion, text-based formats allow full text indexing. Printed pages converted to PDF without OCRing cannot be indexed. I know there is a possibility directly images of pages of a textbook can be converted into PDF, but you cannot index them for full text searching. For long term preservation, images with minimum of 600 DPI and uncompressed TIFF format should be archived, whereas derived files formats like JPEG or PDF can be archived on digital repositories. So in essence, we say use open standards for text, images, audios and video to ensure long-term preservation, so that if it is an open standard, in future we can convert that into whichever popular standard that emerges in the future. This is in a way be called, otherwise called, future-proofing your format. With that, we conclude.